I booked these tickets weeks ago. How does this happen?
Sir, we have a lot of factors going on, and besides that, I can't control...
What about another flight? I'll take a red eye or an early morning flight.
Sir, as I've explained, there is nothing else available.
What's your name again?
Judy.
Judy. Judy, there has to be ways around this.
Sir, I've already told you. We've checked the schedules, scoured the schedules. The flight time.
To get
sir, there
back
is nothing
home.
Left.
Can I talk to your supervisor? I know there's someone above you. I don't mean that disrespectful. There has to be someone above you. Can I speak to that person? I sat on this phone for an hour and a
sir,
half.
Sir, you're in luck. You're talking to the supervisor.
You're the supervisor. Then
absolutely.
Okay. Then okay. Are you close to your mom, Judy?
I don't feel comfortable discussing my family with you.
I didn't mean it that way. I'm just saying, Judy, I have to get home. My mom has had the roughest year, and I have to get home, Judy.
Sir, I realize this is an incredible inconvenience for you, but there is nothing we can do.
So you're saying I'm spending Thanksgiving alone? That's what you're saying.
Sir?
Is that what you're saying? That I'm spending Thanksgiving alone? Just say it. Say it for me.
With
that I'm spending Thanksgiving alone.
Respect,
there's nothing you can do.
Sir. With all due respect, sir, you are not the only person spending Thanksgiving alone.
May I help you? Sure. Come on in. Great. Fred. Okay. Thank you. Go ahead. Have a seat.
Sorry, Someone decided to take a late nap.
No problem.
You want to give them the flowers?
Oh, these are for me.
Thank you for having us.
No. Make yourself at home.
Great, thanks.
Okay. Hi.
Hi.
Oh, wow. This is so great. Hello, welcome. You got pizza. That's awesome.
Yeah,
I love that. Thank you. They're hot, too. Hi. Coffee shop.
So sorry, I almost forgot the turkey.
Brought the bird. Say the word. We'll all sit down and gather around on Thanksgiving Day.
What'd you just say?
I'm sorry, but what I said is that you're not the only person alone this Thanksgiving.
So, how long does it take to cook a turkey?
Well, good morning, everybody. We're glad that you're here with us. We invite you to join us in worship this morning.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. And you called my name
darkness into your glorious day. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. Your freedom is all that I know. The old me knew Jesus when I met you, and you called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. Called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. I needed rescue, my sin was heavy, chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. 'Cause when you call my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day, you called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You're calling me over, you're pulling me close. With love you surround me, you give me hope, yeah, yeah. You're taking me deeper, you're making me whole. With grace you redeem me, yeah, you restore my soul. Now I'm made new because of you. You hold my head up, you remind me who I am. You hold my head up, I'm alive in you again. I'm made new. Oh, your hands you hold me in, you set me apart. Now I'm made new because of you. Oh, you hold my head up, you remind me who I am. You hold my head up, I'm alive in you again. You hold my head up, you remind me who I am. You hold my head up, I'm alive in you again. I'm made new, oh, I'm made new, oh.
remind me who I am. You hold my head up. I'm alive in you again. You hold my head up. You remind me who I am. You hold my head up. I'm alive in you again. I'm made new.
Good morning. So we have got a lot going on in our church right now, which is pretty awesome. Well, we'll start with yesterday. We had our teen quiz meet, and everybody got questions right, and we had three people who placed in the top 10, Meredith in 10th, and Zach in 9th, and Trisha in 5th. And Zach and Trisha both qualified to go to St. Louis for our St. Louis All-Star team. So they did a great job. You can ask them about that later. We do have teen quizzing tonight at 4:30, kids quizzing at 5:30, and youth group at 6 tonight. And Gabe, you got food, right? Okay. We're looking forward to that. What? Yeah, kids quiz at 5, 4:30 for teen, 5 for kids quizzing, 6 for our meal and youth group. After church today, just immediately after the service, if any of our families with kids of any age can meet with us for just a little bit to talk about our kids' Christmas program. We are doing a kids' Christmas program this year. It is going to be December 18th in the morning service. December 11th, we are going to have a practice after church and a kids' Christmas party. So we're going to kind of combine the practice and the Christmas party together. So I'll get that on the church calendar, and you guys can get that on your calendars. Ladies' night. Ladies' night out. I'm trying to not forget until the last week. So that will be November 30th, so you can get that on your calendars to set that night aside, and we'll let you know where that's going to be. Next Sunday, Community Thanksgiving Service is going to be at Paxton First United Methodist Church. There's a service at 5:30 and a meal at 6. So go on and check that out. Go to the service, and if you go, just bring a dish that you can share. There'll be the potluck for the meal. Meat will be provided. Other things we've got going on. Our teens who are going to NYC are doing a fundraiser, which is going to be December 17th. It'll be in the late afternoon evening, and we are going to wrap your Christmas presents for you for a donation, and this will be open to the community. So if you love buying and you hate wrapping, bring your gifts. We'll wrap them for you. You can make a donation of whatever you want, drop them off, leave, come back, pick them up later. But so we'll be here doing gift wrapping December 17th. So if you wait until Christmas Eve to shop, we're not gonna be able to help you. But if you prepare a little bit in advance, we can help you out with that wrapping, and you can help out our teens getting ready to go to Nazarene Youth Conference. You're going to let us wrap your presents, or are you going to come and help wrap? Okay. Okay. I think that's it for the things we've got going on. I would like to say thank you to the church for the pastor appreciation stuff. This was like my first pastor appreciation. It was really weird for me because usually I'm the one going, make sure you remember your pastors. And that wasn't me this year. So I do appreciate everything. I was overwhelmed with your guys' support and gratitude and encouragement. And so thank you from the bottom of my heart.
Carrie is awesome, and thank you from me as well for pastor appreciation. Speaking of Pastor and Carrie, last night, the board unanimously approved for Carrie to apply for her first local minister's license, which is the beginning of the process that I've been going through, towards ordination. She's not completely convinced she wants to be ordained yet, but she does want to be district licensed. But we're going to discuss ordination when we come to that. But so anyway, so as of today, I'm going to send in the paperwork and Carrie's application for her first local minister's license will be put in. So that's pretty exciting. Can I have my two veterans? I got just two, right? I think. Mister, go ahead and stand up. Thursday was Veterans Day, and I didn't get a chance to see y'all. So, I have these, what'd you call these?
Valets?
Okay. I call them cell phone holders. And I handmade these. They've got little inscriptions on them, and by handmade, I do mean I put the screws in. yeah, so anyway, so I wanted to give these. It says, the veteran, the myth, the legend. So, Gabe, that is for you. Thank you for your service.
Thank you very much.
And, no guarantees. Jim, thank you for your service. And I've got Wayne's in the truck. I'm going to go visit him after church today and give him his. So, veterans, thank you very much for all that you do.
Would you join us one more time in song?
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can sing. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You never walk alone, carried by your constant grace, held within your perfect peace. Never once, no, we never walk alone. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful.
You may be seated. Children, come on up front if you would, please.
How are you guys today?
Good, our song, Jude. And I'll try to make, and I'll make presents, but I'll turn to six now.
Okay. So, how are you guys liking the cold weather outside?
Yeah.
Yeah? You like the cold?
Yeah, but
I think most of the adults don't like the cold too much.
Yeah, but I saw the snow coming down.
Yeah, it was snowing some.
Yeah,
so,
but now it's gone, but it's Thanksgiving definitely.
Yeah, it's coming up to Thanksgiving because it's getting cold. So, do you guys know what you want to be when you grow up?
Yeah.
Yeah? What do you want to be when you grow up, Paisley?
I want to be a coffee maker in Italy.
Ooh, a barista in Italy. Fun. What do you want to be, Timmy?
I want to be a donut maker.
A donut maker? And make rainbow donuts? Okay. Right. Okay.
Cakes.
What do you want to be, Ryan?
A football player.
A football player. Justice, what are you thinking? What do you want to be when you grow up? Are you going to be a farmer? Amir, what are you going to be when you grow up? You know what you want to be when you grow up?
Yep.
Not sure? That's okay. Well, do you know in the Bible, in Proverbs 23, it says, there is surely a future hope for you, and your hope will not be cut off. And what that means is God made you, and he knew exactly what he was doing, and he made you for a reason, and he has a plan for what you're going to be and what you're going to do when you grow up. And you may not know this plan yet. Heck, there's some of us that may not know that plan yet, because he keeps changing it. Trust me, he keeps changing it. But God made you perfect for exactly what he wants you to do and the life that he wants you to have. So there is nothing wrong with you guys that you can't do what God wants you to do, because he made you special for his plans for you.
Yeah,
isn't that pretty cool?
Yeah, he made me as a special guy.
He did make you as a special guy who eats cake. Yes. Okay. Cupcakes are good.
And it tastes like rainbow.
Okay.
It tastes like unicorns, I think.
Okay. Well, I want you guys to remember that God made you special just for his plans for you, and you're perfect just the way you are. Okay? So we're going to walk to the back for Kids Zone.
Carrie, what do you want to be when you grow up?
It wasn't a youth pastor.
It wasn't. It's don't feel bad, because even up until about 2020, I was saying I didn't want to be a senior pastor. But God knows what he's doing. Thank you, Phil. God knows what he's doing. And I like rainbow cupcakes too, so he had the right idea. How's everybody? Yeah? I don't believe you. How's everybody? I believe that, actually. I don't. How are y'all? Good. I'm glad you guys are here. I'm glad you're all here. I'm glad I'm here. Anything exciting happened this week that I should know about that anybody wants to say? No, this is the part of the story where we communicate and we converse. Some churches do testimonies. I'm just asking you questions about your week.
Somebody lost their keys.
Somebody sitting next to you, maybe? And Maria lost her phone. This is good. This is getting good. Anybody else want to tell on their significant other? Julie, did Mark do anything crazy this week? Okay. Phil, anything on Julie? You got anything? He's cringing. So he's like, yeah. Well, good. So we finished up our focus series last week, and I want to just talk about a topic right now. Hot mess. Y'all ever heard of that term? Hot mess. Usually, yeah. And it's usually the moms that have a lot going on, and they feel like they can't keep up with everything, right? Yep. So, and sometimes us dads too feel like we can't keep up with everything. But yeah, it's a term I hear a lot more as time goes, and really on social media. Girl, you're a hot mess. That's what I see quite a bit. I don't know about you guys, but I can probably relate with this phrase sometimes. And if you're unfamiliar with it, our culture, it likes to use the phrase to describe things that seem a bit out of control. So it doesn't even have to be a person. I see it online a lot. Like I said, it's usually from the mom that doesn't have things in order. But do we really all have everything in order? Does anybody feel like maybe they're overwhelmed heading into the holiday season? Anybody? Or do you guys not even care? You're just like, whatever. So, what'd you say? Plenty of time. I know. Then got until the 24th. Well, I've already started decorating for Christmas. So, yeah. And Advent starts after next week. So, I mean, I'm just saying. So maybe you've got kids all over the place, or maybe you got a ton of different things going on. Maybe the kids have a ton of different things going on, and you're shuttling them all over the place. Maybe on top of that, you've got a job or jobs, and you have a husband and a wife. Maybe on top of that, you have schoolwork to get done if you're in college or whatever. Maybe on top of that, you have in-laws and parents that you maybe feel like you can just never get it right for. Poor kid. Poor Carrie. Maybe this one's for you, Carrie. The reality is, all of us at some point will know what it feels like to be a hot mess. So today I want us to focus on what is arguably the most important aspect of our life, our family. And I say arguably because sometimes you like each other and sometimes you don't, right? Susan's smiling over here. I'm sorry, Tony. But so my weeks can feel pretty chaotic. At least they do to me. Somebody else might look at it and be like, oh, whatever. But some days I kind of wonder how I got through it. So most weeks I have a sermon to write, which depending on the topic and the content and how much studying I have to do, can take anywhere from 15 to 30 hours. It's a big deal. I have schoolwork, which between reading and writing papers and stuff can take up to about 25 hours of my week, which is just one class. I have a son who is a handful. I will not deny that. And I get up every morning and I get him ready, take him to school. Then I pick him up from school after I've had a chance to be somewhat productive. I take him to his mom's for a couple hours. I go back to get him from his mom's, and I get him home, and I get him supper, and I get him played with, and I take him to bed, and we get up and we do it all over again the next day. I have a house that always seems to need something repaired. Yeah. My mother lives with me, and for the record, my mom lives with me. I do not live with my mom. Okay? She doesn't live in the basement. She actually took ownership of probably the whole bottom floor, but that's another story. she's great help with Clayton, but she often needs my help with some issues throughout the week. And then I have other stuff like interacting with everybody through social media, over the phone, visiting people when I'm able to, going up north to district events, doing administration work. I'm probably even missing some stuff. So maybe y'all can relate to that story, because to me it feels very overwhelming some days. I feel like I don't know how I'm going to make this happen. The good news today is that every life and family can be messy at times. So you're not alone. And it's been that way since the beginning of time. So I want to introduce you guys to a family from the Old Testament, one of the first that we learn about. The family was known in part for their great faith. However, the faith didn't come without some struggles as well. Starting with Abraham, ending with Joseph, I want us to learn a few things from the patriarchs in Genesis. At this point in the story, we know that Abraham has communicated with God numerous times when we get to this family. We know Abraham has communicated with God numerous times. He receives promise after promise of blessings and fruitfulness to come from Abraham's seed. But then God kind of, he gets even more specific as he promises Abraham. We look at Genesis 15:4. It says, Then the word of the Lord came to him, "This man will not be your heir, but a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir." God promises Abraham a son. It's a big promise considering the circumstances. Abraham is concerned about both he and his wife Sarah. They're getting up there in age. So how could they have a child now? We've talked about this before. But how many of you know that even when it doesn't make sense, God comes through? Maybe you know that to be true in your own life. You've got examples of your past and of God's faithfulness and how he's carried you through certain situations. The question that we have to ask today is simple. What promises is God speaking over your life? What promises is God speaking over your life? Maybe you can't hear the audible voice of God speaking these promises, but I believe that if you were to spend some time prayerfully looking at your life right now, you'd experience God's blessings everywhere you turn. It's a matter of perspective. Sometimes if we meditate and we pray, we can get the right perspective. So, often God promises and reminds, and he gives us reminders, and they come from these blessings that we kind of accumulate through our lives. And if we look back, we can be reminded constantly of how faithful God is. And the story goes on as God makes a promise to not only Abraham, but also directly to Sarah. Genesis 18, 9 through 11, or it's going to be 9 through 14, says, "Where is your wife Sarah?" they asked him. "There in the tent," he said. Then one of them said, "I will surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son." Now Sarah was listening at the entrance to the tent, which was behind him. Abraham and Sarah were already very old, and Sarah was past the age of childbearing. So Sarah laughed to herself as she thought, "After I am worn out and my Lord is old, will I now have this pleasure?" Then the Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'We'll really have a child?' Now that I am old," I've left out a word there. "Will I really have a child now that I am old? Is anything too hard for the Lord? I will return to you at the appointed time next year, and Sarah will have a son." So, God promises a son. Sarah couldn't believe it. She was in shock. She laughed at the thought of bearing a child on her own at this point. But sure enough, God came through. Isaac, their son, was soon born and would carry on the promises made to Abraham. So can you imagine the scenario prior to Isaac's birth? Do we start preparing for the birth of a child, or were we hearing things from God that just weren't true? That's probably a question they were asking themselves. Do we go ahead and get ready for this, or were we just mistaken? It's a valid question, I think, all things considered. Had to be a hot mess around that family, I think. But then God does what he does best. He fulfills his promise. Abraham and Sarah learn to do one of the toughest things that we're ever called to do as well. It's trust God, even when it doesn't make sense. When I first started here at the church leading worship, I was working at Lowe's in Danville. I had one of the higher positions just right before management. My salary was pretty good. I had an hourly wage, but it was a pretty high hourly wage for retail. Soon I started to feel God tug me and to move my full-time job to Paxton so I could be closer to the church and it could be a better transition. So I started at Doug's Pharmacy working in the lab making meds. But then it got a little bit weird because Clayton started going to daycare and school and things like that, but he was having issues transitioning. He was having about 4 or 5 transitions throughout the day between people and school and everything, and he was struggling. And the people at daycare really weren't equipped to handle an autistic child at his level. So I kind of had to pray about it. It just became too much for him, too much for the daycare providers. So God called me to quit my full-time job, continue working part-time at the church, and hang out and take care of Clayton. It felt insane. It felt crazy. I had bills to pay. I had a car payment. I had things that I needed to take care of. But God was calling me. It was very clear to me to quit the full-time job and make time. But I also felt like there was no other option, right? You know it feels crazy, but you also don't see any other way. God promised me that he would have me. And he definitely had me. He took the guy who said he'd never be a lead pastor, and he taught him a lesson. In this scenario, there was no other option for me. God took me from a hot mess to a little bit less of still a hot mess. But he took me from a place of uncertainty to a little bit more stability because I trusted him. The world was inviting me to kind of do my own thing and forget about God's promises and faithfulness, and I was scared about money and bills and all this stuff. But I decided that God's track record was flawless. And it is. And he hadn't failed me before. And he hadn't. I'm still standing here. I could believe he wouldn't fail me now. So what about you and your family? Maybe God has been trying to strengthen your faith and reliance on him by putting you in a position that seems helpless and hopeless and feeling like a hot mess. Seems chaotic. Like there's no real solution. There's no end. But he keeps calling you to all these new things. And you have all these responsibilities that seem to be piling up. It feels wrong. And yet God is going to use it to not only produce what he plans to give, but also something important within you and within your family. He's calling you to trust him deeper, to not put it on yourself, to not trust in your own strength. Phil and I just had a conversation about that a few minutes ago. However, the story doesn't stop with Abraham. What about Isaac, his son? The hot mess becomes even more of a mess because Isaac marries a woman named Rebecca, not because of the marriage, not because he marries a woman. That's not why he became a hot mess. They have two boys, Esau, who's older, and Jacob. Based on what we know to be true in the Old Testament era, Esau was the rightful owner of the birthright. But here's where it gets messy. Jacob wants the birthright, and he seems to be willing to do anything to get it, right? He makes Esau swear to sell all his rights as the firstborn child in exchange for a meal when he's hungry. I feel like that would be a good selling point for you, Gabe. I could probably get you to sign anything if I had food, right? That's fair. Jacob does all this without Isaac even knowing it. So how will he get it? This is a long section of scripture, so I'm not going to read it. Genesis 27, 5 through 35. Jacob goes and does his best impression of his brother, so he can inherit the rights of a firstborn son. These are extreme measures that Jacob is willing to go to. But the key component is his co-conspirator in the process, Rebecca, their mom. What do we learn about both Isaac and Rebecca as parents? Isaac, who had a taste for wild game, loved Esau, but Rebecca loved Jacob. They had favorites. Any of you all have a favorite kid? Put everybody on the spot. Yeah, that's fair. That's fair. You're safe if you only have one kid, right? I'm pretty sure my brother's the favorite. Yeah. What? What'd you say? Teddy's a good kid. Oh. Oh, okay, fair enough. Is Teddy your favorite? I mean, Leo's in the other room. It's okay. No, I'm pretty sure I learned my brother's coming into town today with his family, and my mom's doing all this stuff and cooking a meal and everything, and I'm like, he's clearly the favorite. But they had favorites. So I'm not here trying to tell you that how to parent your child, right? But however, I'm here to give you a glimpse into the lives of two parents who decided to have favorites among their children. And it turns into a mess. So what should our response be? I think Jesus sheds some light on this answer in John 15, 12 through 13. He says, "My command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love is no man than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends." It's another one we've looked at more recently. Jesus models for us how to love others as well, no matter what their title or relationship is to us. We saw that in the video this morning too. The guy had to be stretched a little bit, but he opened his house to some people that he normally probably wouldn't associate with. He says the most effective way to love is to love as he loves. So how is that? How does he love? He loves unconditionally. He loves equally. And he loves sacrificially. So we're called to give up a little part of ourselves too in order to love somebody else. Now maybe you're here today and you come from a home where this type of love isn't or wasn't present. Maybe it's a love that you're not used to receiving or giving. I'm here to let you know from personal experience that this is the type of love God has for all of his children. And everybody that can hear my voice right now, here and online, is God's child. He loves unconditionally, he loves equally, and he loves sacrificially, and he wants to draw you close to him so that you can become more Christ-like. This type of sacrificial love requires time and dedication, so there is something that needs to be given from us. It invites us to lay aside our own desires to sacrifice for others. Teaches us to love our family, our friends, our coworkers, and even strangers because of who they are, not what they do. If you want insight into who God loves or who can be a recipient of his love, it's right here. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Our love should be poured out to everyone equally, especially those that we're closest to, our family. It starts there, but it shouldn't stop there. For God so loved the world, and while it might not be possible for us to accomplish the same thing in our lifetime, we may not be able to love the entire world. We can love the entire world. We may not be able to show it to them. But we can extend love and compassion to everybody that we cross paths with. We can love everybody in our world. There's one more progression in this family unit that we need to look at, and that is Joseph. Joseph's one of the 12 sons of Jacob. At one point in the story, he has a series of dreams that his brothers interpret. Essentially, these dreams are elevating Joseph over his brothers, something that they're not a real big fan of. Did you ever fight with your sibling when you were little? No, of course not. Did you get mad when they got something you didn't? Did you get really mad when your parents left them in charge of you? They weren't a fan of the idea of Joseph rising above them. And this family, once again, seems like a hot mess. We're going to look at Genesis 37, 23 through 28. It says, so when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the ornate robe he was wearing, and they took him and threw him into the cistern. The cistern was empty. There was no water in it. As they sat down to eat their meal, they looked up and saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead. Their camels were loaded with spices, balm, and myrrh, and they were on their way to take them down to Egypt. Judah said to his brothers, "What will we gain if we kill our brother and cover up his blood?" You guys haven't ever uttered that, have you? Okay. Just making sure. Come, let's see him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him. After all, he is our... Hold on. After all, he is our brother. It's jumping right off my ear. Hold on here just a second. After all, he's our brother, our own flesh and blood. His brothers agreed. So when the Midianite merchants came by, his brothers pulled Joseph up out of the cistern and sold him for 20 shekels of silver to the Ishmaelites, who took him to Egypt. So they sold him into slavery. But sure enough, Joseph finds himself in this situation. But if we know the story, you know that God's hand is on Joseph. Even though he faces numerous setbacks in Egypt, he finds great success and favor with the leader of Egypt, Pharaoh. He's eventually elevated to second in command over Egypt, a role that puts him in charge of distributing food when a famine hits. His power, his authority, and responsibility become enormous compared to where he came from. But even after all these years away from his family, and now, due to a famine in the land, he'll once again be reunited with them. So how will they respond? Maybe a crucial question for us is, how would we respond in this type of scenario all these years later? Genesis 50, 16 and 17. So they sent word to Joseph, saying, "Your father left these instructions before he died. This is what you are to say to Joseph. I ask you to forgive your brother's sins and the wrongs they committed in treating you so badly. Now please forgive the sins of the servants of the God of your father." When their message came to him, Joseph wept. They understand Joseph's newfound power in Egypt. So they beg for his mercy and his forgiveness. Today, I think you and I could probably agree that forgiveness is a really hard thing. Especially when people have done us wrong, right? Whether we're talking about a family member or complete stranger, forgiveness is not easy. But Joseph, a man of God, decides to teach us that forgiveness is key to a healthy familial relationship, even if it doesn't feel great in the moment. One more piece of scripture. But Joseph said to them, "Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then, don't be afraid. I'll provide for you and your children." And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. Joseph doesn't just forgive them, but he promises to help them in their time of need. When we really think about it, I would assume that this type of view of our family is one that we all share, I would hope. We want to help when they're in need. We want to see them succeed. We want to love them to the best of our abilities. And the Bible reminds us time and time again that forgiveness is an integral part of a relationship with others. Forgiveness is something that God gave us. And he asks us to love like Jesus, which includes forgiveness. So I hope you've seen today that our families, whether we like it or not, will at times be a hot mess. Sometimes we, specifically, personally, will be a hot mess. There'll be chaos. There'll be storms, it'll seem hopeless, be a lot of frustration, and that's not just with our families. Meaning everything around us can sometimes feel too much to handle. However, the Bible has given us keys to respond well in these situations, in these seasons. We trust God. We love others. We learn to forgive. So the ball's in our court in each of these situations. Will we choose to pour out our love equally between our kids? Will we collectively, as a family unit, trust God when it doesn't make sense? Are we willing to show forgiveness to those who've hurt us? In and out of our home. These are key moments and opportunities within our families to grow and mature in this kind of relationship that God wants us to have. Not just with Him, but with others. We've got to engage and trust in God and trust in Jesus if we want to move from chaos to peace. Because peace is possible. And not just later. Peace is possible right now in the midst of everything you're dealing with. A lot of it's about perspective. So would you join me in trusting Him today with your family? Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for bringing us here again today. We love you and we thank you. And I specifically thank you for everybody in this room today, everybody watching online. And I want to pray over their lives as we enter this holiday season. We've got Thanksgiving and Christmas coming up, Advent, Lord, as we ramp up to celebrate the birth of your Son. Lord, I pray that we can all take time to pause and reflect over our lives and remember the moments in our lives where you have been faithful. And then we remember the promise that you will always be faithful. We have heard a phrase a couple weeks ago that if it's not good, then God's not done with it. And Lord, I believe that speaks to your promise that you will be faithful in our lives no matter what we're going through. Even in the hard times, you'll see us through. And I pray, Lord, that you'll prepare our hearts and our minds to love others and to forgive others and to just show Jesus' love to the world, to everyone we come in contact with. Lord, prepare us to go into this holiday season. Our lives are full of chaos and struggle and homework and people that we just do not interact well with, Lord, but I pray we can overcome those barriers and that we can love like you on a daily basis. Thank you, Lord, again for today and for us being together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing still call me friend, 'cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley, and there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Nothing is better than you. glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes.
Today in God's love and peace, you are dismissed.
You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. Turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can.